We're going to begin with the biological aspect. When we're born into this world, we're a small, cute little baby. And as a baby, we grow. Generally, at 6 months, an infant's birth weight has doubled and tripled by their first birthday. As an infant gets older, growth continues. In fact, growth in height usually stops at about the age of 16 for females and around 22 for males. During this growth period, there are a lot of things going on in the body which require a lot of energy. During this period, bones, organs, and other body tissues are getting larger and lean body muscles being developed. All of this growth requires energy. And where does the body get energy from? Well, food, of course. So when we're young, with all the growth taking place, most, if not all of the food we eat is being used as energy to fuel this growth. And that means that not much, if any, fat storage is taking place. Once this growth period stops, we are at our physical peak, and the body enters a simple maintenance stage. So now that high energy requirement starts to decline, and continues to decline as we get older, that is, unless we ourselves do something about it. But we'll get to that in a minute. If we were to try to plot this biological energy expenditure in a graph, it would look something like this. I'm trying to show this from a purely logical perspective, and keep in mind that this graph does not take into account a person's activity level. The left side of the graph represents the energy required for just daily bodily functions. It's not based on calories needed, but on basal metabolic rate expressed as energy per unit of body size. Basal metabolic rate, or BMR, very simply put, is the amount of energy needed for the body while at rest. I didn't put units on there, but I'll get to that in a minute. The bottom of the graph represents age. So in this little graph here, we see massive energy use as an infant and small child. As I mentioned before, infants double and triple in body weight over a very short period of time. Then we see a decline in energy use, but this energy use is still extremely high if you compare an 8-year-old to a 38-year-old. As adolescence hits, the slope of the decline starts to flatten out a bit, and once total growth has happened, the decline will continue throughout the person's life. So now I'm going to put two little points on this graph. One is above the age 18 and the other is above the age 38. You can see that they are the same height on the graph. Let's say that each of these points represents a caloric intake of 2,500 calories. And if I extend a line down from each point, we see that the caloric surplus at age 18 versus age 38 is dramatically different. So at age 18, the body could store this amount as fat. And at age 38, the body could store this amount as fat. Quite a difference. And imagine this caloric surplus available for the body to store day after day after day. That will add up over time. And again, remember, and this is extremely important, this does not take into account how active a person is, just the body's daily functioning caloric or energy needs. Now let's shift gears and look at the typical activity level of a person over the course of their life. We're going to completely ignore growth and biology in this segment. As an infant and small child, we start to crawl and eventually walk. Kids are typically investigating all the new things they're exposed to, running around and playing all the time. They're very active. In fact, we often hear grandparents and even parents talk about how exhausted they are after chasing the kid or kids around all day. As kids get older, they typically continue to be very active. Going to the playground, playing around with their friends outside, getting into sports, and riding their bikes everywhere. They're still running around and being active all the time. Then adolescence and teen years hit, and their activity level may increase a bit because they're still hanging out with their friends and usually doing physical activities or at least moving around a lot. Next up is college years and mid-20s. Here the activity level may stay the same or decline slightly, but most 20-somethings are still relatively active and many have more labor or physical type jobs. Then the late 20s and 30s hit. And here is usually where we see a significant change in activity level. Many people have settled into a desk job where they're sitting most of the day, and doing social activities that require physical movement with friends has come to an end. Going out with friends usually means going to a bar, restaurant, or grilling out at someone's house with very little to no physical movement at all, mainly sitting around and socializing. Hopefully you see the pattern here. The graph of the typical activity level of a person over their life would look something like this, with a continuous decline. Kind of looks like the first graph, the biological graph. Now let's look at the third part of our puzzle. I'm going to call it computer programming. Let's say that this is someone's brain, and as the owner of this brain goes through life, the brain is absorbing and learning. I like to think of it as computer code is being written into it. It's being programmed with educational information, learning to deal with people, understanding right and wrong, and it's also developing relationships. Relationships with family, friends, teachers, pets, and it's also being programmed to develop a relationship with food. As a child, we're often told, make sure you eat. You're growing and you need to eat to grow. But as a kid, we don't care about food, except candy, of course. We want to go out and play with our friends and explore the world. We want to run around all day. Food is the last thing on our mind. But on our journey into adulthood, we're taught a lot of things about food. We often get rewarded with fast food or ice cream after our sporting event or some type of accomplishment. We learn to love junk food and soda pop. And as we continue to get older, we see that graduations and special occasions are celebrated with food. When we were younger, birthdays and celebrations were at a place where we could run around and play. Now celebrations and birthdays are celebrated at someone's favorite restaurant where everyone can sit and talk and not be active. Thanksgiving, Christmas, 4th of July, it's all about the food. This reward system of food and our exposure to bad foods or only eating foods that taste good, regardless of their nutritional value, gets written or coded into our brains. We see boxes of chocolate and restaurant gift cards given as a token of thanks or appreciation. Food isn't taught from a nutritional standpoint, but rather from an enjoyment standpoint. We aren't taught about vitamins and minerals and portion sizes. We aren't taught that food is for energy and nutrients. We are taught that food is about comfort. I'm not blaming parents or teachers or parents of friends. They weren't taught it when they were growing up. And when we reach full adulthood, we have been programmed with the perspective that food is for comfort and taste, not its nutritional value. Our main concerns on a daily basis are our family, our job, and what delicious food we're going to enjoy that day. This is programmed into our brain now, and reprogramming the brain is very, very hard. So now it's time to bring all three segments together. We have a continuous decline in metabolic activity after growth has peaked. We have a similar pattern with a declining activity level, and we have our jaded personal relationship with food. Folks, those are the three main factors of why we gain weight as we get older. Now, there are some exceptions, such as genetic conditions that contribute to weight gain in some people, but for most people, these are the main reasons. There is some great news, though. All of these things can be changed. You can increase your metabolic rate by building muscle mass through resistance training, and eating whole foods will help it as well. Being more consciously active by walking or doing some regular cardio training, and consistently being aware of how active you are. You can educate yourself about portion sizes and learn about how certain foods are digested quickly and leave you wanting more. Of these three, the hardest thing to change is your relationship with food. With work and kids and time at a minimum, the quick fast food is convenient. Of these three, changing your relationship with food is also the most important in regards to weight loss. I know because I've been through it. Here is me in the summer of 2011, and here I am in February of 2012. I was around 210 pounds here. My weight yo-yoed for several years, and I still struggle with food from time to time. I'll do a video about my personal story at a later time, but trust me, this is the hardest thing to change. But it's also the most important thing to change if you're looking to get healthier. All right, folks. If you have any questions or comments, you can leave those down below. If you liked the video, hit the thumbs up. If you didn't like the video, hit the thumbs down, man. It's all good. It is always good. Folks, be happy and be healthy. Till next time, I'm out. See ya.